¡Que comience la función!
I guess it, all of the complexity adds up, but as you were saying, Cristobal, yeah, there was an incident where Nintendo of America translated a game into English. I think it was a Mario Party game, and they used the word spastic, which in America is, I think people are realizing now is not so good, but in the UK, it's really shocking to hear in a game. I mean, it's much less appropriate here than it is in America, but I think
it's not because it's America either. I don't understand. How the hell? I mean, I would never allow that in, you know, my own translations. But if it's aimed at kids, I wouldn't do it. It's just like, you know, I don't. Look, even in Pokemon, I avoided the word crazy. I use it in context of weather, raining like crazy. But to call, you know, I would never have a trainer or you know, a Team Rocket go, "You're crazy" to somebody, because that's. No, that's, you know, especially for a game aimed at kids, man.
Yeah.
Well, especially for a game designed for kids, you know, I mean, to hear that the Spanish, the foreign, the official Spanish translations would be putting in terms and phrases, perfectly okay, you know, regular Spanish, but not in Latin American Spanish. It's, and in having, you know, swear words, etc., applied to, you know, if you're showing up in games for kids, I mean, that's wrong. But the thing that people don't really seem to realize is, like, Nintendo is not a huge company. I'm sorry to say, but Latin American markets that weren't as big as the States or Europe, it's just like things get put on the back burner, and it's very unfortunate. So I'm glad that you guys, you know, took it upon yourselves to try to get things changed to ensure there's Latin America appropriate translation.
Well, first of all, thank you very much for accepting my invitation. Trust me, it's an honor to have the opportunity to talk to a legend like you.
Thanks for having me. Gracias.
De nada, you're welcome. So, all right, of course, we know who you are. We have many questions for you, but we would like to know, in your own words, who is Nob Ogasawara?
Got about an hour? Nob Ogasawara, I'm 60 years old. I'm a cishet male. I was born 1962 to a family of nobles. If the noble system still was in existence today, I would be ruling over the present day Nagano, where the Olympics were held in 1996. I came over to Canada. I was born in Japan. I came over here to Canada when I was six with my parents, and I finished my university, you know, all my school in Vancouver. And I went back to Japan in 85, and I found and started working for a translation agency. Got a job with video game magazines like EGM and GamePro in about 88-89, because I needed a tax write-off, and just got into game journalism. And then I happened to just interview one of the NOA's NOA's vice president at the N64 unveiling, and he liked me and he stole me from GamePro. And that's how everything just happened to fall into place. I was in the right place at the right time. And I didn't make any extra effort to try to land, you know, video game translating jobs, like, which started with Terranigma. And I didn't get credit on that because those two guys stole my credit. friends there. Then they got me the Pokemon gig a couple years later, so I guess I can't complain.
Were you living in Japan then when you were translating your early games like Terranigma and Pokemon, or had you moved? Did you move back to America?
I was just on the verge of moving back to Canada, so I was. So I basically landed the Terranigma job right when I was leaving Japan, and I ended up working in a windowless office for about 2 months. Going crazy on my first video game translation job. So that was in 96. And then after that was done, I worked on stuff like Tenchu and a few other Konami games, I guess. And then I landed the Pokemon gig in about... when did Pokemon come out? Anyway, February 27th, 96. February 27th, you know, when the game came out, that's my birthday. So
I remember that, and
Game Boy at the time was already dying, but it's been out for about 5 years already, and it was, you know, it was in the death spiral, Game Boy. And then, so I figured, oh, okay, well, this is one of the few last Nintendo Game Boy games. Well, at the time, anyway, there was only, like, you know, two or three dozen games left on the release calendar. And I figured, well, okay, so it's my birthday. Let's go. And I ended up liking it, so I played it a lot. And I guess... like September, October of 96, Nintendo of America suddenly called me up and they went, what do you know about Pokemon? And they go, I like it, good game. And they go, what do you think of its chances in the States, or, you know, in foreign markets? And I go, you guys just had a huge bomb on your hands with, you know, Earthbound, because Earthbound was a disaster. There's just no getting around it. You don't even mention the word Earthbound around Nintendo. Mentioning Earthbound and Nintendo around that time was like a bad idea, because they were just like, nobody wanted to take responsibility for it. And it was just, you know, they didn't want to know. They didn't want to. So like, I said, well, you just had a big bomb on your hands with Earthbound. So... you know, on a dying Game Boy, an RPG that nobody ever heard of, it's gonna be a hard sell.
Yeah, it was kind of a big risk at the time.
Yeah, it was a big risk, because, you know, RPGs didn't really sell. Final Fantasy, Final Fantasy III were big hits, but, you know, the Dragon Warrior, the Dragon Quest franchise wasn't really flying in me. Wasn't doing very well, and you know, Enix USA had pulled out of America. They closed up shop because they weren't succeeding as a business. So
yeah.
There was no market for JRPGs at the time. So when did Pokemon come out over here? September 97.
98 in the United States.
98. Yes, so there's quite a long delay after the original Game Boy, original Japanese release. But then it's actually kind of fortuitous, because the anime was already the goal, but there was no other licensed goods available for that for the anime other than the game. So the anime came along and it turned into a massive hit. And the game got dragged along in a slipstream, like a bicycle gets stuck behind a truck. Because there's nothing else to buy, basically. There weren't that many cards yet, even. The cards were, half a year after the anime over here. So there was like a huge demand among kids because they loved the anime, and then they wanted a little bit more. They wanted toys, they wanted whatever merchandise they can get their hands on, and the only thing that was available was the game. So like the game succeeded in Japan. The game was first. The game came along, big success, and then the anime came along, you know, big success. But yeah, it was the other way around in the States. Like the anime came out, that was a huge success, and then just the games came, were like merchandise that the kids wanted because of the anime. And here we are.
Do you think without the anime, it would have gone, the games would have gone the same way as, say, Earthbound?
Could very well be.
Yeah.
You know, like I said, Game Boy was dying. It was pretty much dead. And then right after that, I mean, that the, you know, Game Boy's second renaissance happened. It trucked along for, you know, what, 3-4 more years after, until the Game Boy Advance came along. And, you know, in those 3-4 years, I mean, Game Boy Color, Game Boy, the Game Boy Light and smaller Game Boys. You know, the small guys that ran on two AAA batteries. Like all the new, you know, the hardware revisions came along, and it, you know, Game Boy's life was extended by a good three years as a result of, you know, the Pokemon franchise. And then Game Boy Advance came along, and you know how, I don't have to go through this again, but yeah.
And by the way, we love your shirt. It's perfect for the occasion. I remember that you said that you were working like in the final ROM, in the final version, like not the testing ROM.
Oh yeah. Well, I mean, the game was already out in Japan by then. So there's no, you know, I just played Japanese games to figure out what the hell was going on. Because the first gen was hard because Nintendo didn't have very much experience working with RPGs yet.
That's true.
Like, they'd only done, you know, Earthbound, and then I don't think Nintendo had an RPG other than that. And so they didn't, the programmers didn't know how to set up files for a translator to follow. I mean, they just, you know, they did things by playing by, they had a gajillion files, and the files were all organized by place. And then the text data in each place was like chronological, but you don't know what the timelines are for, you know, this town, you didn't know what the flags were. You didn't know how they fit together. So you have to play the game, figure out what the hell's going on. Oh, okay, this is after something's happened. This is before something's going to happen, so you can't mention it. And it's like doing a crafting puzzle without any clues.
Yeah, well, I can imagine that. Well, I studied computer science too, and I really like to analyze how those games worked before. And man, they were so buggy, everything was so messed up. I really can't imagine how hard it was for you trying to figure out what was, you know, everything. I remember that I read an interview with the Italian translator, and she said that we just had a list of words without context. They didn't tell us these are the attacks, these are the cities, these are names. It was everything so messed up. So man, it's just amazing the work you did for the time.
It was pretty insane. I mean, well, for instance, Pikachu used Thunder Wave or whatever, right? Uh-huh. In the text files, I'd get variable one, variable two, line, you know, hard return, variables free exclamation mark, and that's all I have to go on. But it's like, what?
Damn.
And then I just like started thinking, well, I haven't seen this is battle text. So variable one's a Pokemon, variable two is used. It's insane. But, you know, I figured it all out, and I saw, holy cow, this is really, really hard. And this is like, I was thinking, holy cow, imposter syndrome. So much forgetting to talk syndrome. My father's doing a bad job. And then the chief programmer, Mr. Murakami, was, he checked my text over, and he goes, oh, geez, look at that. He made another dumb mistake. And he come back at me and he goes, look, we found hundreds of text errors. You got to fix all this. And he's all like, wow, this is not acceptable. And I was like, oh, geez, just like losing confidence by day. And then the European localization happened and they came back with thousands of text errors. So then he came, Mr. Murakawa, came back to me and he's like, oh man, you did a good job, saying, pal. And he said, oh, thanks. At least you have told me while the project was ongoing. But yeah, So I felt vindicated. I felt vindicated after the fact, but while I was working on it, it was just like, oh, geez, this is so hard. And also, you notice, in Generation 1, there's only 18 characters per line.
And in the second line, only 17, right?
Yeah. Well, the word congratulations is, is 12 characters. You gotta, really trim a lot of context to make everything fit. And they made it even harder by going, you can't use 18 characters. You could use 18 characters in the first line, but you can't in the second line. Why not? Because there's a text prompt. You've got to have the room for the little triangle so you can make things more. So 18, 17, 17 thereafter, that's not a whole lot. It really isn't. You go try writing 18 character lines to make sense. That's why you get weird shit like chunky shorts.
and trust me, in Spanish, it was even worse because the Spanish sentences, they tend to be larger than in English. So there were so many mistakes. I remember the word slam, the attack slam, was translated as door slam into Spanish. It was so strange, so weird. And that mistake remained until the Generation 6.
Oh!
Yeah, around the Generation 6. Many other mistakes.
Once you make a canonical mistake, like when you name a move after, the move slam after door slam, once you make that kind of mistake and it becomes canon, you got to live with that. Until somebody comes along and says, no, that's not it. But until somebody puts their foot down, you got to live with slam. It's just like stuff like I hated poison pin Nidorans, poison pin Pokemon. That's not poison pin, are you nuts? That's like it's like a toxic barb or something, but it's not poison pin. But once you etch that into stone, it's gotta stay. Is it still poison pin Pokemon?
Of course, as well, the European translations were based on your English one. Did you know that when you were writing the English that it was going to be used as the basis?
I didn't know until after the fact. And then, I mean, you know, when I was still working on my English text, it was just like, holy cow, this is hard. And this is really, I'm not thinking about French guys or German guys or all the rest. And then after that, you know, after Generation One was done, I get told, well, you were the basis of all the Euro languages. I'm like, oh, hell. Because, you know, I'm optimizing for me. I'm optimizing the writing for English. I'm not thinking about the German guy, the French guy, the poor Italian, you know. Don't care. Not my job. You know, yeah, I know, because German grows a lot relative to English. And he just told me, Spanish grows a lot. So it's just, I got my money.
And of course, English already is longer than the Japanese was in the first place. So it's kind of all getting longer and longer with each step of the process.
Yeah, you're looking at English when you translate, you know, from Japanese into English, and especially if it's when you're just using, you know, this phonetic language. Well, see, Pokemon wasn't too bad because the Japanese was all phonetic anyway, so it would grow to about double. But once when you get into the kanji, the symbol characters and that, then you're looking at English would grow physically about 2.5 times what the Japanese was. And then, wow. You know, German grows even more on top of English, so... good luck with that. So when, you know, when we went to Game Boy Advance and we had like 30, I guess we had like 40 characters per line, well, that felt like ocean, man. It was just like, wow, I could actually use big words. And I talk to some of my contemporaries now and they go like, oh my God, there's only 40 characters per line. And it's like, luxury. On you. Let me tell you how it was when it was. Yeah, I used to walk 6 miles of snow, school in snow. Yeah, anyway.
I mean, what about kind of some of the cultural references? How would you say that came up a lot, or was Pokemon not too Japanese culturally based?
I don't really. I mean, there's obviously going to be cultural references, but there weren't like really typical Japanese references, like, you know, eating satsuma oranges in kotatsu, you know, heated table. There wasn't that kind of like really, really overtly Japanese references, except I guess for like the Tin Tower and stuff, there were some more, you know, religious, well, kind of like more tradition based things, but there wasn't all that much really serious. Like, it's not like Yakuza, for instance, which is like a pain in the ass to translate.
Questions? Well, I would like to know, what is your view on unofficial translations?
If they're not making money off it, I don't see a problem with it at all. As soon as they start advertising and trying to, like, you know, bring traffic to their website and that, it just gets a little weird. But, you know, for people to have, just, you know, enjoy having, doing mods and stuff, I don't really see a huge problem with it. I don't know what Nintendo Legal would say, but me, you know, that's just me personal. I mean, just like, go ahead, all the more power to you. Don't burn stuff, or don't put files up for sale.
That's true. Yeah.
Just like, it's like, you know, whatever. It's like fan mags, or, you know, like doujinshi, like the Japanese fan magazines, the fan comic. You know, just so long as it's not eating into, it's not, so long as it's not harming the franchise itself, or, you know, you're really raking in huge amount of money and not paying taxes on it. I mean, that, you know, that then it gets to be problematical for the company, for the license holder. But, you know, I think most of the time they're willing to just, you know, pretend it's not there. Like, you know, they probably pretend that this shirt is not there. Now, let me tell you about the shirt, by the way. This, I bought this off Etsy. And it's a private, you know, just private artist. You know, I don't think she's paying copyrights or anything like that. But it's star salt. Like salt, like, you know, salt shaker salt, star salts, and yeah, on Etsy.com. So yeah, you should check her out. So, I mean, it's 100% cotton, and it's the quality's beautiful. It's there. But he's cool. Yeah, I mean, it's probably one of the best shirts I've ever bought in terms of construction and that. So yeah, something on.
I really like the design. It's very kind of festive.
Yeah,
I agree.
The other ones, she's got the Halloween ones too. It's like, you know, ghost Pokemon and that. Yeah, if you're a fan, you should check it out. Etsy.com, salt, the star salts. There you go.
It's interesting what you were saying about doujinshi or fan comics. It's interesting. I find it very interesting that all of these companies kind of just turn a blind eye and kind of don't worry about it, because I think it's kind of this unique ecosystem.
It is. Well, it's, I guess if it's a positive one for the franchise, for the fan community, I think they're willing to turn a blind eye to it. You know, if you're turning into, like, you know, if you're turning into Sailor Moon into hardcore porn with reality or child, you know, child abuse or whatever, I mean, that's problematical.
Yeah.
But, you know, if businesses can tell too, right? I mean, if somebody's doing it maliciously or if it's out of love. And I think, I mean, for instance, I think it would be wrong for Nintendo to shut down, you know, all the fake Mon artists, the people that do, you know, design Mon, you know, do monster designs of their own time. I think most people are willing to turn a blind eye to it. But, you know, if you start doing stuff, malicious stuff with it, or, you know, this is my rape Mon or something, I mean, it's just like, ooh, no, that's, you know, that's a line that's being crossed. So, yeah. But that's me, you know. Go ahead.
Talking of fan projects, I mean, Cristobal, do you want to kind of talk a little bit about the campaign to localize the Pokemon games in Latin America?
Oh man, there's so much to tell. Dude, it was so hard trying to get their attention. They are not the kind of company that are kind of close to their fans, or that they answer to some petitions. They just don't say anything. It's really hard trying to get to them for anything. So I was like, how can I spread the word about this? Because, Junov said that you weren't aware about it, and probably most of the world wasn't aware about it. I mean, this is something that we have been asking for decades. It's not something that we are asking just today, you know? So I was like, okay, I sent the petition about this very big problem, and they literally said, no, we don't care. We don't accept ideas or anything. In other words, so I thought, what can I do? What can I do to get their attention? Okay, I need Ash and Brock. So, you know, in Latin America, it's easier to do these kind of things. Probably in the US, it's really hard to contact the voices for Ash and Brock. But trust me, here is very easy. I mean, I have the contacts, and the law here is not as strict as in the US. So probably if the US had a campaign with those voice actors, they would be in trouble, right? But it's something that is not happening here. So I had the contacts, we made an agreement, and we did it. We made a video trying to explain this big problem, with swear words. And well, you not saw the video and you left your comment, right? And many like 2 months later, Thomas, you made the video in English, right? Yeah. Well, Thomas did an amazing research about it. He explained everything perfectly. And maybe I sent him some information too. But yeah. It was big. I mean, you know, it's a big issue. I know that a lot of people just laugh about the problem, about the bad words, but it's a big issue. These are games for kids, and that's why localization is very important.
Well, especially for a game designed for kids, you know, I mean, to hear that the Spanish, the foreign, the official Spanish translations would be putting in terms and phrases perfectly okay, you know, regular Spanish, but not in Latin American Spanish. It's and in having, you know, swear words, etc., applied to, you know, if you're showing up in games for kids, I mean, that's wrong. But the thing that people don't really seem to realize is, like, Nintendo is not a huge company. Nintendo America is not a huge company. It's like, you know, Nintendo proper is only like, you know, 1,000 people or something like that in Japan. There's high schools that are literally much bigger than these places. So, and they're working on multiple franchises. It's not just Pokemon and Nintendo, you know, they got Mario in the right. And so to, you know, focus on, I'm sorry to say, but Latin American markets that weren't as big as the States or Europe, it's just like things get put on the back burner, and it's very unfortunate. So I'm glad that you guys, you know, took it upon yourselves to try to get things changed to ensure there's Latin America appropriate translations. And from what I'm hearing from you guys, what you guys have, you managed to get at least the card translations to be done for Latin America now?
Yeah, the last video game, Pokemon Trading Card Game Live, was the first video game ever to include a Latin American Spanish localization, but not that good. I mean, the text of the game itself has a translation into Latin American Spanish, but the cards from the game are still with the European Spanish translation. And the problem, again, is that there are still some terms from Spain that are swear words in Latin America, and they are still using them. But I think there's an explanation. Here we don't get only the video games in European Spanish, but also all the Pokemon merchandise, or at least most of it. So maybe that's why they wanted to join both markets, like using the same translation for both markets, because it's easier, but it's not appropriate.
No, it's not. I mean, well, it comes down to, like, you know, how many, like, Latin American markets, you know, have to step up and show that their market worth, you know, the extra effort, I guess. I mean, you know, don't pirate, guys.
But it's not really that hard. I mean, actually, I have a theory, and maybe, Thomas, you can explain this deeply. The incident about the word spastic, right, in the UK, that was in 2007, right?
Yeah, I mean, it comes down to, as you were saying, you know, I mean, it's Pokemon is obviously all around the world, and I think it's quite unique because most big video game franchises characters have like the same name. You know, Mario is called Mario in every part of the world. But with something like Pokemon, where they all have, there's unique names for the characters in a lot of regions, and I guess it all of the complexity adds up. But as you were saying, Cristobal, there was an incident where Nintendo of America translated a game into English. I think it was a Mario Party game, and they used the word spastic, which in America is, I think people are realizing now is not so good, but in the UK, it's really shocking to hear in a game. I mean, it's much less appropriate here than it is in America, but I think
it's not because it's America either. I don't understand. How the hell? I would never allow that in, you know, my own translations. But if it's aimed at kids, I wouldn't do it. It's just like, you know, look, even in Pokemon, I avoided the word crazy. I use it in the context of weather, raining like crazy, but to call, you know, I would never have a trainer or you know, a Team Rocket go, you're crazy to somebody, because that's, you know, especially for gaming, the kids, man.
Yeah.
You know, it's Pokemon, and Pokemon's an entry level game for, it's baby's first RPG. It's not meant to be mature adult content. So to use that kind of, like, you know, that kind of derogatory term is just wrong. You know, it's not welcoming to the kids. It's not fair to the player. So the word spastic is like, ooh, no.
Yeah.
Why? I have no idea why something like that would slip through the cracks. But that's a big failure.
I guess it just goes to show that, you know, all of these games are made by people at the end of the day, and people can kind of, things can slip through the cracks, as you say.
For sure, yeah.
But yeah, I mean, the game was recalled from the shelves in the UK, so.
Wow. It was quite an interesting. Wow.
that's poor.
I mean, going back to Pokemon, I mean, Nob, what were some of the kind of difficulties you faced in the translation of, especially as the games went on with the early, you know, with especially Gen 1, it was a lot of technical problems, but what other kind of challenges did you face in the generations that came afterwards?
Well, technical problems always remain. You know, variable 1, variable 2, variable 3, exclamation. I mean, that didn't really change much. Another thing too is, like, once you say a certain thing, like, for instance, a Pokedex, if you explain a certain Pokemon had poison pins, it has to be poison pin forever and ever, and you know, and then I'm just handed Japanese text, but I don't remember poison pin, so I'd have to go demand my old files back so I can see what I wrote in the Pokedex before. And wonders, somebody at Nintendo decided I'm a security risk, so I'm not allowed to look up my old text files, even though I wrote them.
Really?
So I was just like, well, I need my Pokedex data. And they go, well, you can't look at that. And I go, why the hell not? And then you can look at your games. And I go, you mean I got to fill my Pokedex completely? And I was like, are you kidding me? So, you know, just thank God for Sarah and Bulbapedia.
Wow, that definitely makes sense.
You know, just like using unofficial sources like that. It's just like, you know, I imagine other translators do the same too. Instead of, you know, if the official won't come to go to bat for you, then we'll find other ways. But I mean, it's our job to make sure it's going to be poison pin forever and ever, even though it's wrong.
Wow. Well, at least I think that in other languages they have fixed things like that. If they did that in our languages, I don't understand why they are not doing the same in English. But anyway.
Well, once you have the etched into stone, I mean, that's what it is, right? That's kind of, you know, can't talk about it. You know, once you tell a lie, you got to double down.
I mean, did you manage to get poison pin changed, or is it still like that today?
I believe it's still poison pin. You know, I mean, there's a lot of weird things that, you know, when you start thinking about that, hurts your brain. I mean, like, why is Nidoran male-female two different species, right? you know, the stuff like that I would think about and I would go crazy. So I would just, yeah, no.
Yeah, and it was the same with Mr. Mime.
Huh. Yeah. you know. Because, well, Mr. Mime is kind of understandable because Gen 1 didn't make the, you know, didn't make the sex thing separate, right? But I could see it coming. And I said, you know, I told my guys at NOA, you know, they don't have species, they don't have gender things yet, but if you look at needle rounds, there already is a gender divide. And I said, it's going to, I think, Pokemon Gen 2 or whatever, when it happens, you're going to see that. And I said, this might be a bad idea, and this might come by, it might come back to bite us in the ass. Nah, it's all right. You know, Gen 1, we're not sure if this is even going to succeed.
Probably they thought the same in Spanish, like, oh no, the translation from Spain is perfect. Keep using it. It's not a problem. It's not like, no one is going to complain.
Yeah, no, nobody has foresight. It's just like, well, we got to get this. We got to schedule. We got to get this baby out. So, yeah. You know, legal's already approved that. We don't want to go back to legal again.
But I have a theory, actually, because maybe Thomas can confirm this. From 2007, Nintendo Translate, Nintendo makes two translations, right? Like one for the UK and another one for the US, right? Because of that incident or not?
Yeah, I think Nintendo has definitely, you know, in the early 2000s and 90s, the UK got the same translation or the same English as the one in America, and I think they definitely have started producing their own ones at Nintendo of Europe. It depends on the game, I think, a lot of the time, but certainly some of them you see completely separate translations from Nintendo of Europe and Nintendo of America. And it's interesting to see how different translators have kind of handled the, you know, have done their own takes on the Japanese material.
Yeah,
nice. Nice.
No two translators will give you the same output. It just doesn't happen. Because we all have different styles. We all have different voices in our head. All good translators should have like characters that they can picture, like an old guy, like, you know, and an old guy for me, what might be, you know, like might be a Morgan Freeman, whereas like for an Englishman would be like, you know, maybe Sir Michael Caine or like Ian McKellen, right? So just because of the frames of reference of whose voices we're hearing when we're writing, you're writing dialogue, you're going to see a difference. I mean, there's just no getting around to it.
Yeah, I mean, I often hear the phrase that translation is an art, not a science. There's not one correct way. It's all different, you know.
No, there really isn't. I mean, look, even if you want to just talk technology, I mean, throw the same sentence at DeepL and Google Translate, you'll get different answers. Right? Even machines aren't consistent.
Yeah.
And when you got old farts like me was a different set of, you know, frame of reference, you know, or hungover. Yeah. You know, same as a perky 20-some-odd child, you know, a young person writing the same way. I mean, just the slang is different. Just the voices that we have in our heads are different.
Do you think your translation work has changed over the last, you know, 15, 20 years as you've, you know, had more life experiences and such?
For sure, yeah. I've gotten much better just looking at literal text in this one. We don't need all that crap anymore. Just, we don't have to worry. You have to, like, see, the problem with, like, a lot of younger, well, not younger, excuse me, starting translators would be being too slavishly literal and too respectful of the original text. So they would try to, you know, be more literal in meaning. But then when you read it, when you read it back, I mean, it reads awkward because no English speaker would say it that way. It might be grammatically correct, but it's still unnatural. So I've gotten much better at just like looking at text and just like rewording everything so it sounds more natural, more in character than worrying about the original, you know, because you're writing for the reader. You're not writing for the original writer.
Yeah.
You know, you want to respect what they did and you want to respect what their intent was, but the person reading it has to feel it's natural. It has to resonate with the reader, not with the writer.
Yeah. I mean, what would you say one of your games is that you translated that you think you wish more people would go out and play?
Mystery Dungeon.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Mystery Dungeons, definitely. Those are really, really good games. But no, well, the Mystery Dungeon style isn't for everybody. And I mean, I've had fights with people like Pokemon fan YouTubers, and then they do Let's Play videos of Pokemon games. And then these two clowns did Pokemon, you know, Mystery Dungeon, and they've never played it before. And they just ripped it apart, and I was like really choked about that. You call yourself Pokemon expert, but you don't know this material, and you're just ripping it without even attempting to understand it. So it's just like, yeah.
I think there are a lot of passionate fans of Mystery Dungeon out there. I mean, as Nintendo recently brought one of them onto the Switch, I believe. So yeah. There are diehard fans out there who really do like this game.
Yeah, well, thank goodness.
All right. As far as I know, Pokémon Platinum's translation was held by the Pokémon Company International rather than Nintendo, right? So, what differences do you notice between working with the two companies?
Well, I'd probably step in on some NDA issues there, but I'd already established my working style and communication, lines of communication with Pokemon, with Nintendo of America and with, you know, Nintendo of Japan, who were handling the localization programming that. So, I had our procedures that worked for us, but then TPC came along and they wanted to do things differently, and they didn't like me speaking with Nintendo of Japan directly. So that added an extra layer of communication, communications, and that, delayed things by days. And that, when I'm working hard. Like, I'm working 14 hours a day, no holidays, and I'm just trying to get, I'm hammering, and so I don't need several worth of delays over, one little chunk of text. I mean, it didn't make any sense to me. Just like, when I had the original line of communication, so I could just go, send a text message, what's going on here? And they come back to me with an answer. I'm like, okay, good, done. So I can move on right away. But with TPC, it just add an extra layer of bureaucracy that wasn't. I didn't feel helpful. It just made things more complicated and slow.
Yeah. I mean, I guess any kind of shake up to the way things have been going, it does kind of make the process more complicated and more difficult.
I mean, first, when for generation one, I mean, the translation and localization teams are like, several people from Treehouse, the people I was directly in contact with, Nintendo of America, were two. And so, I mean, the localization team for Gen 1 was like maybe half a dozen, right? And then come, you know, generation four, I mean, we're talking lots of people with their fingers in the pie, messing around. It's not Yeah.
Wow.
You know, I mean, people all want to get involved in a big project, and you know, they want to get their name in the credits and stuff, so, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, what are some of the projects you've worked on since Pokemon that you're most proud of then?
Yakuza.
Yeah, I mean, that's a huge one.
Yeah, Yakuza. Yeah. I worked on, I got the, well, I had the privilege of working on Yakuza 5. I was a part of a team, though. I didn't, you know, I didn't, no way. I mean, Yakuza 5, Yakuza franchise games are huge. Yeah, a single translator. It would take a year or two to get that, get through all that. So I was, you know, a team of like half a dozen each time to get these five, get these a zero. Anyway, I don't know who to help staple together all those different ones. What a nightmare. But yeah, like for Yakuza Zero, I did all the sub quests. That was a lot of fun because those are, that's where all the humor is in Yakuza. And the mainline parts are always about intrigue and who's killing who, and you know, really, really dead serious gangster stuff. And then, the side quests are like, you know, gotta deliver pizza.
I guess it must have been really different working on that from Pokemon as well, because with Yakuza, people are going into it knowing it's going to be very Japanese, and so you kind of want to keep as much of that culture in. Whereas with Pokemon, you want to kind of keep it more neutral.
Yeah. Pokemon, like I said earlier, Pokemon's like, you know, more universal. So the experience is more, there's more commonality. You know, people everywhere in the world can kind of relate to, you know, but Yakuza is like strictly, you know, you mess with my honor. I mean, just like, you know, so I'm gonna come after your mother and your children. So that kind of kind of, you know, different set of values, and just even the relationship between Yakuza family figures, like, you know, there's always this talk of, you know, big brother, you know, and then younger brother, father figure, and it's like, it's not directly translatable unless you're familiar with, you know, mafia movies, and even then, it's like, it's not. There's no one-to-one, you know, he's the Don, he's the Capo. It doesn't really work that way, so yeah. So you have to, like, figure out how to express that so, you know, you guys can understand. Anyway, so it's not, yeah, that was, I lost a lot of sleep over that one.
I was just gonna say, I think it's always a sign of a good translation when people kind of don't even notice it or think about it. And I think with Yakuza, I mean, people can play it and don't even think about how much kind of work must have gone into making it all come across so naturally and understandably to people who have never, you know, lived in Japan or interacted with Yakuza culture in any way.
Right, yeah, it's like, you know, to bridge that gap is like very, very hard. Yeah, it's challenging. It's fun, but it's stinking hard.
Yeah.
Oh. You know, I mean, it's just, translating from Japanese is like, it's tough too, because there's so many different kinds of protocols, different levels. You know, if you're talking to somebody above you, you speak in a different tone, as opposed to when you're talking down to somebody or like a child, for instance, people take on different tones. And to get those relationship rules across, or there's even stuff like when you talk, there's like certain terms, like when you, you know, for a woman that's over 30 would be obasan. Well, there's no such saying in English. So, you know, don't call me obasan, call me onesan. It's like, you know, don't call me an older woman, call me this. Well, it doesn't translate.
Yeah.
And have you done the opposite? like translating from English into Japanese?
I've never done that.
Oh, okay.
You'll find most translators will only go one way. You know, the translators that do two ways, they're a rare feature. It's like you're usually one master of one native tongue, and then the other one is like, is an application thereof, so it's a little different. You can, I just very, like I said, there's very few people that do bilateral translations. If not, you know, yeah, because I mean, I can read anything that's thrown at me in Japanese, but then to be able to come up with appropriate Japanese terms, it's not an instantaneous thing. I have to think about it, I have to agonize it, and then I have to screw around with the grammar. It's not that easy.
And talking about common mistakes, probably you often see common mistakes. So that's my question. Well, what's the most common mistake you see in game translation?
Plural. Well, in Japanese it is anyway, because the Japanese language doesn't have plural. So it could be one man attacking you in the dark, it could be a whole bunch of men.
Oh,
or,
right.
You know, well, for instance, I worked on Dragon Quest, and that had multiple, well, like, you know, unlike Pokemon, like Dragon Quest would allow multiple enemy monsters to appear at the same time. Well, like Pokemon does now, but before, Dragon Quest would have, like, you know, three slime appeared, or one slime appeared. But you never knew, so, like, some of their text would be, like, a monster appeared. Well, it's not, you're not sure if that's actually a monster or multiple monsters. So that makes life really miserable. So, and that also has problems, you know, causes problems when you're going to a shop, for instance. Like when you want to go buy armor or potions at a shop in an RPG, like you go, how many would you, okay, you want potions, how many would you like? And you'd have to like turn the text around so you avoid having to use potions, right? Because you know, oh, you want 99 potions. Well, you can't, because it's either you want one potions.
All right.
Right. You know, so you have to go. So I'm pretty proud of this. I changed, or I screwed around with the text so it would go, okay, so what do you want? Okay, potion it is, all right? Well, how many would you take? Like, made sure I avoided having to use the word, you know, plural form of potion or potions. Now, you know, I was pretty proud of doing that, because it's the only way of avoiding that awkwardness.
I remember listening to an interview with you in a podcast where you talked about the attack line in Pokemon where it says you were challenged by, or that was what you ended up with, but there was a long process to get there.
Yes. Well, I mean, the very first gem was, what do you call it, you know, Team Rocket, fight, right? And then I thought about it for Gen 2 and I thought, well, fight is a little strong, you know, fight is violent. So I thought, well, okay, well, battle, I think battle, you know, battle softens it up a little bit. So, all right, for Gen 2, we went with, you know, Team Rocket Billy wants to battle. But Gen 2 was when they also started doing multi-trainer battles. It was like, you know, Farmer Bob and Daughter Sal wants to battle. Well, wants to battle is wrong, because it's like, you know, multitude, you know, it's grammatically wrong. And so the suggestion was, well, why don't we put, you know, want bracket S behind it. And that's a lot. And I said, so for Gen 2, we just live with wants to battle into thinking, you know, because there's only like 3, 4, 5, you know, team battles in Gen 2. So we just left it at that. But then Gen 3, that's when, like, you know, Farmer Bob and Daughter Sal became pretty much, it became pretty common, right? So wants to battle was not very good, was dramatically ugly. So what did they come up with? Would like the battle. Would like the battle is like lame, man. I mean, just, you know, you got dramatic music, dun dun dun, and then all of a sudden, you know, Billy and Bob would like the battle. Like, come on, that's lame. So, you know, and I was like, no, we got to think, we got to change this. We can't leave it with, like, the battle. That's, like, the lamest shit ever. And they go, well, and Nano 8 was like, no, we already came up with it in Treehouse. We all agreed this is a workable solution. They go, but it's a workable solution, but it's a horrible solution. I said, this is just, like, this is the lamest shit ever. Lamest garbage ever. And they said, no, we got to keep it that way. And I hated that always too. Like, you know, what was that? That was Ruby and Sapphire, Emerald was all that way, and Fire Red, Leaf Green was that way too, right? Yeah, would like the battle. Like, yeah. God, this is lame. And then Gen 4, I mean, I was thinking, how could I make this non-lame? And then it parsed on, you know, Ace Attorney, you know, the turn table turning thing. And I said, well, so let's flip it on in. Then we go, oh, hey, you are challenged by. And I said, well, that's perfect because you can be challenged by Bob or you can be challenged by Bob and Bill. And it all, and I also, you know, I also said, when sometimes the trainer, your character will be with an NPC. Like in the mines, for instance, like Peter would come with you, would come with you. So like, you are challenged by. Well, I said, well, see, when I'm with an NPC, you are still works. It's not you. You know, it could be applied to just me, Hiker Knob, or Hiker Knob and Peter. You know, my buddy here. Right. So I said, well, that and it could it works. It's grammatically perfect.
Yeah. Yeah. Fortunately, we didn't have that problem in Spanish. I'm trying to remember. Yeah, the phrase was like, I'm translating it, just wants to battle, and that's it. But in Spanish, sounds better. And you're challenged by, no, it was something like prepare for a fight with insert name. That's the word in Spanish. That's the phrase in Spanish.
That's a solution.
That's perfect, yeah. It avoids, like, you know, the grammatical problem. Yeah, and then that's the way it should have been, but, you know, I don't know. I mean, sometimes you gotta wonder, like, come on, guys, this is a game for kids. It's gotta sound cool. You know, would like the battle is like, it's just,
no, it sounds weird.
You know,
yeah.
He walked up a polite ask, would you like the battle? No!
No way.
Right? So, yeah.
So you worked on the series from Gen 1, 2, 3, and 4, and then is that when it switched over from contractors to doing it in-house then?
I believe so, yeah. Yeah. And that was when the transition happened from TPC wanted entire control of the whole localization process, and Nintendo was okay, well, you can do that, but you can't use Nintendo resources. And they called me a Nintendo resource, even though I was freelancer. So
I mean, it's obviously still all of the phrases you coined to kind of translate these terms back in the first four generations are still being used to this day. I mean, you know, you were challenged by is still showing up in Sun and Moon and Sword and Shield. And
yeah, well, because it works.
Yeah.
It was an elegant solution. I mean, I'm glad somebody recognized that as an elegant solution, but you know. But I haven't out of the picture, so I have no idea who's working on what anymore over there.
Yeah, but your work is very much the blueprint for all of the ones that follow still, which is...
Absolutely.
Did you have the chance? Oh, no, you go ahead.
Well, this is for... Okay, generation... Yeah, generation three. The names of the characters, did you name them or they were just, you just got the names? For instance, May, Brandon, in Pokemon Emerald, for instance, or Ruby and Sapphire. I mean, do you remember the names of the main characters in Pokemon Ruby and Sapphire?
No.
I was wondering if you had to translate the name or create the name, or if you just got them.
No, those were usually handed to me.
Ah, okay.
Like everything in all caps, like you know, Pokemon name, items name, place name, people name. 99% was done by Nintendo, you know, of America. Just like, here you go. Use these. You know, so often they would get stuck on, like, names of monsters or places, and they go, what do you think? And I would go, well, dude, how about this? And then they go, okay, we like that. Okay, we'll use that. Or they might go, we like that. We'll put it in consideration, and maybe it'll show up or not, you know. So, like, they like my idea of hop, skip, and jump for the jump love and the, you know, the green guys. Anyway, yeah, they like those suggestions. They changed it around a little bit, but they wouldn't use stuff like I saw Spiritomb's original. I came up with Spiritomb's name as Phantom, and they didn't like that. No, okay. Wow. And Scantler, I came up with Scaraboo. Yeah, you know, that was fine. Okay. But
well,
so often I would see something that would be so egregious, like Generation 4's Old Chateau. Is that Gen 4 or is that Gen 3? The ghost.
I think it's Gen 3.
From the forest, the one with the ghost in it. I think it's Gen 3. And,
never mind.
But, they wanted, in the Japanese, like the old chateau and the old gâteau, they were actually the same, they were homonyms, they sounded the same. Morino Yokan. And that was like, you know, chateau in the forest, but it also translated red bean cake, which is a, you know, kind of, and they in a way just translated as such, like, you know, forest mansion and red bean cake. And I said, no, you can't do that, because these were actually homonyms. That was the joke. You have the cake and they have the same name. And then I said, let me think about this one. Let me take this home and think about this one for, you know. So eventually, old chateau, old gâteau, it rhymes. I'm going with that. You know, 3 hours on $2, you know, a buck for a singular.
Wow, it's a pity they didn't keep the Britney Spiro nickname. That was brilliant. I can't believe they changed that.
Yeah, they didn't. Because it will still work for a lot of people. It wasn't, see, in a certain way, like when you're working with something, it's not always a passion project. Like, you know, with fans would go the extra mile to try to make certain jokes work, or, you know, because they really love and care, as opposed to people that get paid to do a job. You know?
Yeah.
I mean, I see it, but there's a further, I cared a lot because I started it. You know, I started as a fan of Pokemon. So I was, you know, for me, it was like a passion project. But for some people, I mean, it was just a vehicle to get their names in the credits. And I'm not, you know, I'm not naming any names, but yeah.
So the Pokemon names almost entirely came down from Nintendo of America then, did they?
Yeah.
I guess a lot of people needed to be involved. I mean, there's kind of coordination between Nintendo of Japan, Nintendo of America, and then later on the European side of things, and obviously...
Okay. You know, and then trying to get Game Freak to understand what the hell we're talking about.
Yeah.
And Game Freak needed a lot of, you know, there was a lot of issues we had to explain how the hell it worked, and
they never expected it to become this like international phenomenon when they created those early games.
No, yeah. Well, I mean, like I said, when I got, you know, first interviewed for the job, I got asked, you know, how do you think Pokemon's going to do? And I go, it's a challenge. And when we were working on localization, I mean, when the product manager was like, you know, if you don't do X number of units, you guys are fired.
Wow.
Well, we, you know, so they ended up making twice the X number of units and sold overnight.
Wow.
It was insane. I mean, Pokemon the games, they came and went in about a week from the stores. I mean, it was pretty insane. I mean, I was pretty happy. I went to a local supermarket chain that's not, you know, very well known for games, and I just, you know, went to their tiny video game area, and they found two copies of Red, and I thought, oh yeah, okay, there, finally found them in the wild. But, you know, other than that, like, you know, all the GameStops or EV Games places, you know, places that you'd think of games, like Walmart, those places were like stripped clean in a matter of weeks.
Yeah.
And then nothing else came for a long time.
Yeah.
You know, September, like I said, like the anime came out, what, September-ish of 98, I guess. And then for three, four, and then the cards were like half a year later. So you know, people loved the anime, but they couldn't get any other spin-off merchandise other than the games. And even the games, once, you know, first wave sold out, you know, you had to wait a month. You had to wait several months before they would get restocked. And this is like, you know, Christmas time of 98 too. So, like, you know, there's also all these other games that are taking up manufacturing time and manufacturing priorities. So, you know, there was a huge void, huge demand for Pokemon merchandise.
Yeah.
Wow. You guys are so lucky. Well, you as a translator, you know that terminology is very important, like consistency. And that we were talking about that. Trust me, here in Latin America, the Pokemon terminology is a mess. It's a complete mess. Because, you know, for the anime, we got the names from the United States, right? But we got the games from Spain, and they use completely different names. So if the same character appears in the video game, it has a different name. So that's the reason why Pokemon is actually, Pokemon video games, I mean, they are not really popular among little kids, because they just can't understand. They don't understand the slang from Spain They have to read bad words, so what? So actually, Pokemon is very popular here, Pokemon games, but with adults, because they can play in English most of the time, or they just don't have big problems with the slang from Spain. But for a little kids, oh man. So this is just not only for us, but for the future generations. They deserve a good localization for us. And that's why I think it's really important. You should localize not only by languages, but also for cultures, I guess.
Yeah. No, there needs to be. That's why it's such a huge undertaking. I mean, you know, there's a lot of canon in those video games. There's a lot of canon in those the anime for just one point now to figure out, to get everything consistent. That's a hell of an undertaking. It's probably a job, you know, probably deserve, you know, it's a fun job for, you know, insane. I mean, it would take a really passionate and involved fan as opposed to a person who gets paid, you know, to do a 9-to-5 job. I mean, it's just, the level of passion is not the same for you know, for a guy just getting paid to do a job as opposed to, you know, some kid who's grown up with the franchise and that, you know, they do. And there's so many people that live, eat, and breathe Pokemon. It's amazing. When I got to do the translation of the game, I thought, like, you know, I played the game for hundreds of hours and I thought, I know my shit. You know, wow. I don't play Pokemon competitively because people would wipe the floor with me. it's amazing. These people, they figured out how to breed. Fans figured out the numerical ratios involved in getting a shiny. I mean, that's insane, man.
It was. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, scrolling through like Bulbapedia, any single page, it's so much detail. It's just amazing.
Wow! You guys got way too much time on your hands. Thank you. And I'm just amazed. It's like, what's the amount of passion that it must take? Yeah. The focus it takes for people to figure that out. I mean, you know, it shows you how much love there is for that game and for that franchise. Yeah, it's amazing.
Yeah.
I mean, those of, you know, I'm a 9-to-5er compared to those people.
And but, I mean, playing the Pokemon games has inspired a lot of people to get into translation as well.
That's true. Yeah.
What tips do you have for someone kind of looking to get into translation right now? I'm sure it's kind of a different world now than it was, you know, even 10 years ago, but.
You got to let your passion speak if you're working on a game franchise or manga. Like, you got to love what you do.
Yeah.
You know, when I was doing a 9-to-5, I mean, like 9-to-5ers could do it, but nowadays, I mean, you just say, you know, translating Yu-Gi-Oh games and such. You have to know what you're talking about. I didn't Yu-Gi-Oh games, right? It's just the parameters have changed a lot more. There's a lot more. The parameters have changed for the healthy, I guess, because, you know, people know what they're talking about when they're getting involved in video game translation. So you gotta love what you do. Oh God.
Yeah. I think that's great advice.
I have another question regarding, well, I have a theory actually. We were talking about how popular was Pokemon back then. You know, at that time, as Thomas said in his video, we are talking about the year 1998, right? Yeah. We got all video games only in English, but the Pokemon here was so popular that Nintendo, they launched for the first time ever the games in Spanish here. But like half-half. This is the game, actually. This is the game, if you can see, we have the everyone classification from the United States. Like, we inherited the classification. And it was amazing because this description is in Latin American Spanish. The manual inside of the game has a translation into Latin American Spanish, but the game itself is with the European translation from Spain. So it was half-half. I was wondering if the translation of this in English, did you do that in English, or it was half-half? Oh, okay. You didn't have to translate like the description of the boxes, manuals, and things like that.
The only manual type thing I did was for Gen 4, a booklet. No, not even Gen 4, I might say Mystery Dungeon, I did a booklet. About yay thick.
Oh! Oh, wow!
Why is it backwards?
Oh, what? That's amazing.
Yeah. I did these books for a Mystery Dungeon. Of course, he didn't give me credit on it, bastards. But but yeah, that was the only manual-like stuff I did for Pokemon. I was kind of surprised you didn't need to do manuals, because I knew the terminology, so I had, you know, I could be all consistent in that. But you know, I'm not stealing somebody else's job.
Yeah, I guess that's kind of a different area. Like, that's almost more into marketing than like the focusing on the game itself.
Exactly. Yeah. And you know, I was just the game translator. I mean, it's very stratified at Nintendo. Everyone has their own little fight stumps, and yeah, people do their own thing. All right.
Hey, welcome back.
Is that a different shirt?
Yes, it is.
Oh, it is. Yeah.
I bought two, so yeah.
Is that from the same Etsy person then?
Yes, it is. Seriously, good quality shirts.
Christopher, you said you had something.
Oh, yeah. I have a theory. Maybe you, Mr. Knob, can help me with that. I will try just playing this the better I can. Let me think for a few seconds, okay? All right. Well, in 2007, Nintendo began splitting their translations, right? So they made one for the US and another one for the UK, right? And at the same time, they did the same in Spanish from that year. They started to make two different translations in Spanish too. One for Spain and another one for Latin America. So I always wondered why they didn't do the same with Pokemon games. And maybe it was because at that time the Pokemon company held the translation. So do you remember the year when you worked for the first time with them? I think it was the year 2008 for Pokemon Platinum, right? It was your last Pokemon game.
Yeah, I'm trying to think of when the 2PC actually started doing that. I'm pretty certain that 2PC was in control of Platinum. And Ranger 2.
Mm. Ranger 2. Oh, yeah.
Ranger 2 was definitely TPC, but I'm not too sure when exactly TPC took over completely on that. But TPC USA wasn't a very big concern. It wasn't a big company yet. I mean, Pokemon, it was, like I said, Nintendo's a very lean company. There's not a whole lot of people. I'm not too sure So maybe, you know, TPC not willing to do a Latin America translation, and, you know, separate ones for, you know, Europe, Spanish, and Latin America. So I don't know if they had the resources to even do that.
Actually, my theory is that, let's imagine that Nintendo began translating into Latin American Spanish 1 year before. Then the Pokemon Company would have been forced to keep doing that translation. So for just 1 year, we didn't have our own translation. But it's not that bad because I met you thanks to that, and I had the chance to talk to you when I asked your opinion on this issue. So thanks to them.
And so the Pokemon Company International was very much separate from Nintendo, and they did their own thing then, you would say?
Yes, they did. Once Pokemon, you know, the TPC went, TPC, well, that's why I'm out. Like, I was a Nintendo resource rather than TPC resource. So yeah, so that's why, you know, people like Eve Eschenberger now went over, was working with TPC on like Pokemon Mystery Dungeon.
All right.
You know, I wish I would have worked on Pokemon Mystery Dungeon 3, but, you know, them's a break. So. Not 3, I guess, but Pokemon Explorers of Sky? I think one I didn't work on that, yeah. I would like to, you know, complete that trilogy, but, you know, them's a break. So.
Yeah. What's the newest, most recent translation project you've worked on that's out now, then?
It's the Tokyo 2020 Sonic and Mario. Mm. And then since then, I've been like, I've always been, you know, a marketing translator anyway, marketing ad. I've always worked in marketing and advertising. And games were, like, games don't pay very much, all right? So, you know, it's so much easier to make. You know, make a living doing. I mean, I have to work like a demon to make things work with games. I was working 14 hours a day, 70 days straight with no holidays. Some crazy stuff like that.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't do that with my, you know, marketing stuff. I do my 10 pages a day and I'm making good money. But, you know, I mean, for game translations, manga translations, visual novels, light novels, all that stuff. The pay's not very good, man. People have to work like a demon. Like, people have to work really, really hard to make ends meet. So, you know.
Yeah, that's like, true. And trust me, here it's 10 times worse.
Yeah, because we just don't get. I'm sorry, but, you know, translators don't get much respect because people don't understand what the hell we do, to be honest. Mm. You know, why can't you just do it word for word? Because it doesn't work that way. But even the paid people that pay us the money don't really understand what we do. Well, they pay us money because they don't understand how the process works. We understand. We're like the little wind-up monkeys. Wind them up and off go, right? So, you know, until the market and our paymasters understand exactly what we do, our lot's not going to improve. Plus, I mean, there's more and more and more people working in translation. So, you know, the supply of good translators, and there's a lot of good ones out there, are outstripping the demand. So for entry-level jobs like manga, light novels, visual novels, games, I mean, the pay is abysmal. There's just no way getting around it. So, you know, if you want to make money at translating, you've got to get into other stuff. You know, I mean, that's a hard truth. I mean, you got to get into doing patents, you got to get into advertising. You got to get into local. I mean, it's a very hard way of making a living. So, you know, be nice to us. We're doing it.
Do you see that? Oops, sorry, I was just going to say, do you see that changing kind of going forward? Do you think that translators working in kind of games and manga are going to get more recognition, or do you think it's kind of going to stay how it is for a while longer?
I see people like David Ireland and Steiner. People are trying to get, you know, Christina, people on Twitter like Christina. Those people, Blickwinkle, people like that are making an effort to get their names known. People like Al Kajia, the guy that worked on, Alex worked on the Ace Attorney series. Mm-hmm. People are trying to get their names associated with games and franchise, but it's not easy. I mean, there's just so many good translators, and they just, you know, companies are like, don't understand. The agencies don't understand. So they're going, well, translators are expensive. We can replace them with machines, right? So I don't know. I don't see the market improving to any huge. I don't have enough hope to see, you know, translator names on book covers along with the original writer. It happens, but not very often.
Yeah,
there has to be a huge there has to be a huge shift in the way people perceive and think about games and, you know, and translations. But, you know, there's a certain percentage of idiots who think localizers are putting in their own political or gender agendas, you know, they're just different, their own values, and ruining, you know, Japanese games or whatever. So when that kind of hostility toward, you know, translators, localizers exist, I mean, I'm not very optimistic, no.
Yeah.
Needless to say, but, you know, we do it because we care.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's true. I think maybe Thomas asked this question before, but I'd like to know, well, in my case, you know, I struggled a lot to learn English. I mean, I studied English for 5 years, and I thought that I knew English, but when I visited the United States, it was so hard trying to understand what people were saying to me. They were talking too fast with so many slang and so on. So you live the same. I mean, you were born in Japan, but you moved to Canada when you were around 6. So I'd like to know, how was the process for you for a kid, like adapting to a new culture, a new language? Do you remember that process?
That sucks. It totally sucked. I didn't understand a bloody word. You know, but you drop a kid in an immersive situation, you know, sink or swim, and I swam. You just listen, you absorb, you just observe how other kids speak, you observe from TV, you just, a kid 5 or 6 will absorb, and they will become bilingual. That's all there is. And that's what happened. Yeah, I mean, I didn't speak very good English until I was, you know, grade 4. I mean, it took me years. It took me 5-6 years before I could actually, you know, converse perfectly normally. You know, but kids muddle by, right?
Yeah.
I love to read. I'm always been a reader, so I read a lot, and I just absorbed through that, through reading. But it sure sucked.
Okay, Thomas, do you have any other question? I think we are almost done.
Yeah, I think that has been very, a very comprehensive look at your history of Pokemon and with translation as a whole. I mean, do you have anything else you would like to say to people watching the interview?
Thanks very much for your lovely talk. God bless you. You guys make it all worthwhile.
That's very nice.
Yeah, it is.
I mean, look, I'd be here if it wasn't for the love of fans who enjoyed my work, who enjoyed the work of others involved in the franchise. So, yeah, I'm grateful. And, I'm amazed and humbled by how many people still to this day write to me saying, Pokemon made their life, their childhood happy, or it was the old. I mean, it really breaks my heart when I see kids going, Pokemon saved me from a shitty childhood. I mean, I hear that. It just hurts, man. So I'm glad. It hurts and it humbles me. So I'm so very, very grateful that I had the opportunity to be a part of something that turned out to be so bloody huge. I didn't expect this. And I'm grateful that, it lets me speak with people all around the world. I talk to you guys. It's amazing. It's cool what's going on. So thank you again. Gracias.
Well, gracias a ti. Thanks to you. I actually learned my first English words thanks to you. I mean, I remember when I was like 10 years old, trying to play Pokemon Blue, trying to understand what is back, what is item. But, I really learned all of those little words because of you. So thank you very much. Well, yeah, I really appreciate the hard work you have done. I understand the work that goes into translating these massive games. And I just really appreciate your work and for taking the time out of your day to answer all of these questions. So from the bottom of my heart, Mr. Nov, thank you very much. Domo arigatou gozaimasu.
Arigatou. Gracias. All right. Take care.
Take care.
Take care. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Nos vemos en la próxima.